There's a term in true crime called the less dead. This term is often used in relation to victims who were people of color or who worked in the sex business or in the drug world, or sometimes both. These people are often referred to as the less dead because in the mind of the general public, these victims didn't matter as much. It is a terrible truth, but a truth all the same, that people have a natural tendency to think in this way in our country. So when multiple people, most of them involved in sex work, all go missing from the same city, well, it can be extremely difficult to find someone to take these cases seriously enough to connect them. So when we don't do this important work, we may be allowing for a serial killer to continue taking lives. This is the case of the West Mesa Bone Collector, and more importantly, the case of his victims. Before we begin today's case, I just wanted to remind everyone that if you have a case suggestion, you can pass that on to me by using the link in the description box down below. There you will also find things like contact info and relevant case IDs and more. Now, if you want to know what sources I used in today's case, I always pin them to the top of the comment section below the videos. Now, I cannot stress this enough, especially today, that it is extremely important that you watch this video all the way through. This case involves the deaths of multiple women who fell directly into the category of the less dead. These women were more likely to be targets, and they were more likely to not have their disappearances taken seriously. It is extremely important that we do not allow the investigation into these deaths to not be taken seriously either. Now, each of these women deserves for her story to be told and heard out, so please watch the video in its entirety to understand the stories of these women and what happened to them and where we can go from here. Now, in addition to this, I wanted to state before we jump into the case that I will be discussing the activities that these women partook in. This involves prostitution and drug use. And while I am mentioning these facts about these women, I want to make it clear right here that I do not believe that in any way these things mean that these women deserved to be attacked, or that it means that it isn't important for their murders to be investigated. Anyone in the comment section who implies any such thing will have their comments removed, as this will not be tolerated on my channel. But now into today's case. Albuquerque, New Mexico is a large city that is no stranger to crime. Like most large cities, there are areas where prostitution and drugs are known to be found. Albuquerque's Central Avenue is known to be one of these places. It's often referred to as the war zone, and it's known to be a dangerous area in town. So it wasn't necessarily a surprise that some women had disappeared from the area. But one officer would begin to connect these cases, developing a list of missing women and a very big question that should have been tackled as soon as it was asked. Could there be a serial killer targeting prostitutes in Albuquerque? Now, in the mid-2000s, Detective Ida Lopez had returned to work from a medical leave of absence. To ease her back into work, she was assigned a part-time job looking into missing persons reports. This would lead Detective Lopez to notice a number of similarities between multiple missing women in the city. Now, these women were often in their 20s, had been going missing from a common area between 2001 and 2006. They were often Latina, and they were all sex workers. Detective Lopez began to make a list of cases that she believed could be connected. In 2007, an article was published about Detective Lopez and her list of missing women in the Albuquerque Tribune. It was hoped that this publication would get the case the attention that they needed to convince other officers of the Albuquerque Police Department to open full investigations. The list wasn't picked up by any other publications, and the cases continued to go largely unnoticed. Cases of missing sex workers often don't get the attention that they deserve. Sex workers are considered to be a category known as less alive, people who are considered to be less important in the general public mindset. This category also largely includes women of color, which many of the missing women on this list were. For many departments, officers have trouble rationalizing advising spending time or money on a case of someone who they believe lived a high-risk lifestyle and may have deserved what happened to them, or may have simply decided to move on their own, perhaps traveling to a different city in the hopes of making more money as a sex worker somewhere else. Detective Lopez's list would ultimately be thrust into the limelight, however, when bodies were discovered buried in an arroyo bank in Albuquerque's West Mesa. An arroyo is a naturally occurring thing where a gully or creek is formed by a natural water flow through an area during the seasonal rainfall. The arroyo in question here was located near a building site. In 2006, KB Holmes began building near what would be discovered to be a burial pit. A part of the burial area had actually been leveled out during prep work for future houses that would be built over the spot. In 2008, however, the housing bubble collapse led the company to cease construction. However, the disruption of the natural arroyo bank led to issues with flooding in the area. So to direct the water away from the residential areas, a retention wall was built. Now it's believed that these things ultimately helped to slowly unearth the first to be discovered bones. It was a morning like any other for Christine Ross as she walked her dog not far from her home on February 2nd of 2009. During this walk, her dog Ruka found a bone which he promptly brought to Christine. Upon seeing the bone, she felt that something was very wrong. Christine took a photo of the bone and sent it to her sister, who worked as a registered nurse. The sister confirmed what Christine had been worried about, that the bone was human. It resembled a human femur bone. Christine reported this to police and they quickly responded. Officers arrived on the scene and it was determined that the remains were indeed human. It wouldn't be long before officers knew that they were in for a long haul of an investigation at the site. By the end of the month, it would become clear that there were multiple bodies. By the time the officers had unearthed all the bodies, there were 11 women and one fetus who were determined to be victims of the West Mesa murders. It would eventually be determined that most of these women were Hispanic. Nearly all of them had a history of prostitution, drug abuse, or both, and most of them had disappeared from an area of Central Avenue, which, as I mentioned earlier, is a known location for sex work and drugs. And this was between the years of 2003 and 2005. So who were these women? Each of them has their own story, and it's important that we cover them all individually. Victoria Chavez was the first victim to be identified by the New Mexico Office of the Medical Examiner. She was identified through dental records. Victoria had been last seen by family in 2003, but she wasn't reported missing until March of 2005. According to those closest to her, she had lived a hard life and had multiple arrests for both prostitution and drugs. So leading up to Victoria's disappearance, however, there seemed to be a time where she was getting her life back together. She was working in a local restaurant, she was staying at home, and she had apparently been considering going back to school to be a nurse. It is believed that Victoria was murdered and placed in the burial site sometime in the year 2004. Michelle Valdez, whose full name was Gina Michelle Valdez, was the second woman to be identified. Michelle was the oldest of three sisters and was described by her mother as fun-loving and always having a smile on her face. Now, as she reached the status of teenager, she became progressively more rebellious. Michelle became a young mother to a daughter and a son, but eventually she became mixed up in sex work and drug abuse. Even while struggling with these things, her family says that she was still very loving to her children and that she cared deeply about what was going on in their lives. Eventually, Michelle would be away for long periods of time, and then she would just show up again looking for help or some sort of money. Now, at one point, she never returned. Michelle was officially reported missing by her father in February of 2005. It is unknown when she actually went missing. It's also unclear if she was aware that she was pregnant at the time of her death. When Michelle Valdez died, she had in fact been 4 months pregnant. Police believe that Michelle had been murdered and buried sometime between 2004 and 2005. Something important to note, though, is that Michelle's mother and sister, Karen and Camille, had been hearing rumors prior to the bodies being discovered. The word on the street was that Michelle had been stabbed and dumped somewhere in the West Mesa. Some rumors even claimed that the same happened to another victim who was later identified, named Cinnamon Elks. Julie Nieto, the third identified victim, was born to a single mother, and she had one sister, Valerie, who she was very close to. Now, as a teenager, Julie became the mother of a son who she very dearly loved. At 19 years old, she tried drugs for the first time, and after that, things sort of went downhill. Julie eventually had 4 total convictions for prostitution-related crimes. Now, she had last been seen in August of 2004, and she was reported missing not long after this. Strangely enough, though, she would also be reported missing by 2 separate women who gave different dates for the time of her disappearance. Now, over time, with Julie still missing, her sister fell into a depression. She died of a drug overdose in 2006, which the girls' mother believes was a direct result of Julie's disappearance. Cinnamon Elks was the 4th body to be identified. Cinnamon was described by her mother as a perfect child growing up. It wasn't until she entered teenage years and she had started experimenting with drugs that anything seemed to be wrong. She eventually gave birth 2 times, and she loved her children a lot. However, she often wasn't capable of caring for them. There would be periods of time where no one would hear from Cinnamon, but she would eventually just show up. In all, she faced multiple arrests for prostitution and drug-related offenses. Her last arrest was in July of 2004, and it was after this that Cinnamon disappeared, and her mother reported her missing about a month later. However, an official police report wouldn't be filed until months later. This was in December. Why would this be? Because the police told Cinnamon's mother that adults can go off whenever they want without contacting family. Her mother, Diana, was certain that something had happened to her daughter, though, because her daughter hadn't called to wish her a happy birthday. This was something that Cinnamon had always done, even when she hadn't been in contact with her family for a long period of time. Now, police didn't take this information seriously, though. Shortly before she vanished, she had actually told friends that a dirty cop had been chopping off the heads of prostitutes and burying them on the West Mesa. Cinnamon had seemed to those who knew her to be worried about something. In addition to this, her mother, Diana, had received multiple calls after Cinnamon's disappearance from someone that claimed that Cinnamon had been beheaded and buried in the West Mesa. Now, Diana says that she reported these calls at the time that they had happened, but police never investigated them. They were never able to discover who was actually making these calls. It was made public that Cinnamon had actually known more than one of the other women, including Victoria Chavez, Michelle Valdez, and even possibly Julie Nieto. Monica Candelaria was the 5th victim identified. Monica was born in Albuquerque and lived a life where she was well loved by her parents and her brother. Monica would also become a young mother, giving birth to a son named Michael. Eventually, however, as has been a pattern so far in the lives of the women discovered in the West Mesa burial site, Monica became involved in drug use, which only continued to worsen over time and led her to prostitution. Monica was last seen on May 11th of 2003. She had been near Central Avenue, close to Atrisco Drive, when she disappeared. It seems that Monica's case was actually investigated actively by police for a period of about 6 months before the investigation dwindled. During the investigation, however, there were many rumors passed on to police about what may have happened to Monica. Her mother, Isabel, also passed on a rumor that she had been told about Monica, that Monica had been killed by a man from their neighborhood named Isaac, and then she had been buried in the West Mesa. It wasn't until February of 2009, nearly 9 years after the disappearances, that police would find her remains. Now, Monica was identified on April 3rd of 2009. Veronica Romero was the 6th woman identified in West Mesa. Veronica had been an only child growing up, and she was known to be quite close to her family. Veronica was last seen in early February of 2004. She was on Central Avenue, this time near Wyoming Boulevard. There were some witnesses from the night that she was last known to be seen on Central Avenue. These people said that they saw her get into a white pickup truck. It was either February 14th or 15th that she was reported missing, and this was in 2004. Now, Veronica was also identified on April 3rd of 2009. This was just over 5 years since she had gone missing. Veronica was a mother of five children who have lived nearly two decades without their mother. Doreen Marquez was the seventh woman to be identified. Doreen, like the other woman, had eventually turned toward drugs, but it seems that this happened later in her life. Now, Doreen had become a mother young, like many of the other women we've talked about. She had two daughters named Destiny and Mercedes. Like the other women on the list, she loved her children dearly, and family said that she was very active in her children's lives. She was described as bubbly and fashionable, and it was important to her to wear nice clothes, to get her hair done, to get her nails done, and just to look presentable overall. In her 20s, though, Doreen's boyfriend was arrested and sent to jail. So it was after this that Doreen had actually developed a problem with drugs. This led her to disappear for periods of time without contacting her family, which would ultimately make Doreen's last known sighting hard to pin down. Now, a friend claimed to have actually seen her sometime in 2004, but her family hadn't seen her since October in 2003. Doreen wasn't reported missing until December of 2004. Now, her body was positively identified through dental records as one of the West Mesa victims. This was on April 21st of 2009. Solania Edwards was the eighth victim to be identified. Solania was originally from Texas, and she was born into a family of a total of eight siblings. Now, at the age of five, Solania would be separated from her mother, and she and her siblings were placed into foster care. Solania eventually ended up in a foster home in Lawton, Oklahoma, from which she would eventually run away. Now, she was at some point added to the endangered runaway list in Oklahoma. After Solania ran away from her foster home, she had been sighted in Aurora, Colorado. It was reported that she may have been staying at the Ranger Motel and had been seen with known prostitutes on East Colfax Avenue. Some reports seem to list three names possibly belonging to women that Solania had been with at some point. Those names were Lucretia, Ty, and Diamond. Officers reported that Solania may have been using the nicknames of Mimi or Chocolate during that time. Solania was the only victim in West Mesa who was not from New Mexico. She was one of the only two who was only 15 at the time of their deaths, and she was the only Black girl among the victims. Solania was identified on June 4th of 2009. Evelyn Salazar was the ninth woman to be identified, but her identification came after months of no other positive IDs being made in the case. Evelyn was a mother to two girls, Mariah and Angel, and she enjoyed cooking and the outdoors. Now, like the other women so far that have been identified, she had problems with drugs and she worked as a prostitute. Unlike these women, however, she disappeared alongside someone else. Evelyn had been present at a family gathering with her younger cousin, Jamie Barella. Now, the two left the gathering together, and they were known to be headed toward a park near San Mateo and Gibson Boulevards. The area of the park wasn't too far from Central Avenue, where many of the women who had become victims were last seen. The girls were expected to return in about an hour, but they never came back home. Now, this was in March of 2004. Evelyn and Jamie were both reported missing on April 3rd of 2004, and Evelyn's remains were identified on November 18th of 2009. Now, Virginia Cloven was the 10th victim identified. Virginia's father, Robert, had described her as humorous and someone who couldn't lie. She was also a teacher's favorite during her school years, according to an interview that her dad gave to reporters. Virginia would lose some of her unique personality and charm, however, after one of her brothers had been shot and killed. Now, following his death, Virginia ran away from home, and it wasn't long after this that her brother did the same. So this was only the beginning of Virginia's known troubles. She had moved in with her boyfriend after running away, but he was later hit by a car and the incident left him in a coma. Following this, Virginia had become homeless, and as often happens in such situations, she started doing sex work and she developed a drug problem. Virginia had been arrested a number of times over the years, but as far as seeing her family, that didn't really happen a lot. At most, they received random phone calls from her, but there would be long periods of time where there was silence from Virginia. The last call came in June of 2004 when she called her father to tell him that she had a new boyfriend and she thought she might marry him. Now, her father, Robert, described the incident in the following quote: "We said we'd like to meet him, but we never heard from her again. After that, everything just went dead." Virginia wasn't reported missing until October of 2004 because it was common for her to go for long stretches of time without contacting her family or friends. She was identified as one of the West Mesa victims on November 18th, 2009. Jamie Barella was the last victim to be identified. She was only 15 at the time of her disappearance and had never been known to participate in sex work or drugs. This set her apart from the rest of the victims, all of whom, with the obvious exception of the unborn child, had histories of prostitution and drug abuse. There was only one time that Jamie had ever previously disappeared, which also set her apart from the other women. During that particular incident, it was quickly determined that Jamie had run off to live with her dad as her parents had been separated. Now, Jamie disappeared alongside her cousin Evelyn Salazar in March of 2004, was reported missing on April 3rd of that year. There was no reason to be found for why she may have voluntarily gone off, and her family assumed that it hadn't been a choice she had made. Jamie was identified on January 27th of 2010, almost a year since the initial discovery of the burial site. Each of the women buried in West Mesa were nude. There was no clothing or belongings ever found. Now, a lack of evidence to support any other method of murder led medical investigators to believe that strangulation was the most likely cause of death for each of the women. According to autopsy reports, one medical examiner stated, "Some acts of violence, such as strangulation or suffocation, may not leave any detectable injuries to skeletal remains and could not be ruled out by this investigation." The investigation into the West Mesa murders was expansive. Though investigators initially refrained from using the term serial killer, it was obvious that each of the women discovered in the burial site had to be connected. Before long, the APD set up what they called the 118th Street Task Force, named after one of the two streets the bodies had been found near. The task force was made up of officers from multiple organizations, which included the APD, Bernalillo County Sheriff's Office, the FBI, the Office of the Medical Examiner, the District Attorney's Office, and the New Mexico State Police. During the investigation, police brought in a number of resources, which included ground-penetrating radar to search other locations for potential remains, cadaver dogs to help them determine these other potential burial sites. They even did flybys of the area to look for patches of disturbed desert, which may indicate other potential burial grounds. They also involved archaeologists, psychics, and even an astrologer, who they enlisted to help determine if there was any zodiac sign or constellation pattern significance that they should be considering in relation to the graves. One thing that greatly helped officers determine a timeline of events was the use of satellite images from the U.S. Geological Survey. On these satellite images, there was a progressive change to the environment where the bodies had been found that didn't have anything to do with the construction in 2006. These images made it clear that the bodies were likely being dumped between 2003 and 2005. Some of the areas showed the first tire tracks in the area, which would continue to be present and become more pronounced over time, and they also showed patches of dirt that had been clearly disturbed, which were determined to be the women's graves. Now, eventually, there were no new graves or new tire tracks. Then, the area had been leveled off during the construction in 2006. Using these images, investigators were able to determine that the last body had likely been buried in 2005. Now, what the images can't tell us, however, is why the killer stopped. Did they move to another burial site? Did the upcoming construction spook them? Did the killer themselves pass away or end up in jail? These are all possibilities, but they are also all questions without certain answers. Years later, there were more bones that would be discovered near the site in West Mesa. This was in June of 2018, but testing eventually revealed that these remains were actually ancient and not connected to the West Mesa murders. Over time, the term serial killer would become more widely used by law enforcement officers working this case. Locally, it seems that the killer had been dubbed the 118th Street Killer, but to most of the general public outside of Albuquerque, the killer is most widely known as the West Mesa Bone Collector. In the year following the discovery of the burial site, a reward of $100,000 had been funded in the hopes that it would entice someone to come forward with information. This reward is still available today for information leading to the arrest or conviction of the person or persons responsible. As far as suspects in this case, there were several. One of the first suspects was a man named Fred Reynolds. Fred operated a business called Have Mercy Escorts and had been known by police and others to be involved in the sex work industry. Over the years, there had been multiple arrests for Reynolds on prostitution-related crimes mostly. Now, one of the things that led him to be a suspect was that he had relationships with some of the victims. There were also rumors that he had been asking others about the girls when they were still just missing. Now, when Reynolds was announced as a possible suspect, multiple people who knew him, some of which who also knew some of the victims, spoke up and they told reporters that they didn't think for a second that Reynolds was capable of doing this. According to these people, he had been genuinely concerned about the well-being of these women and he was hoping that eventually they would return home. Now, eventually Reynolds was cleared. Now, a much stronger contender of a suspect was Lorenzo Montoya. Montoya lived only about 3 miles from the burial site, and it was reported that satellite images may have shown tire tracks that led from near his home to the area that the bodies had been buried in. Montoya was violent. He had a violent history, especially towards sex workers, and he was known to frequent Central Avenue in the search of prostitutes. In December of 2006, however, he set up a meeting with a prostitute. The woman was named Sherika Hall, and in an attempt to protect herself, she asked her boyfriend to come along and wait outside for her. This man was named Frederick Williams. Now, Williams had sat in his car for about an hour outside of Montoya's trailer before he became worried enough that he decided to check on Sherika. Details about what happened next are a little lacking, but Williams seems to claim that he caught Montoya with Sherika's dead body, possibly trying to carry her to his vehicle. Now, there may have been some sort of fight that ensued, but ultimately, whatever happened, in the end, Williams had shot and killed Montoya. According to officers, Sherika had been tied with a rope that had been made of duct tape, and they actually believe that this may have been a technique that he had used before against other women. Attempts to link the West Mesa murders to Montoya have not been successful, but there also hasn't been specific evidence to rule him out as a suspect. Most of what we know is that none of the victims' DNA was discovered in a patch of carpet that had been tested from Montoya's home. Lorenzo Montoya is still considered to be a viable suspect to this day. Another suspect from early on is a man named Ron Irwin. Irwin was a photographer from Joplin, Missouri, who had traveled to New Mexico numerous times between the mid-90s and 2006. Irwin had friends who lived in New Mexico, and upon his first visit, he decided that he actually liked photographing in the desert environment that surrounded him there. There have been no reasons officially given as to why Irwin was a possible suspect, but in August of 2010, his home and his business in Missouri were raided. Reports indicate that a truck full of evidence had been obtained, and eventually some of this evidence was returned to Irwin, but not all of it. It is believed, though, that one of the things taken during this raid was a series of photographs, which were then published in December of 2010 by law enforcement. Some reports say that the photo origins are unknown, and some of them seem to point to the photos having been obtained from the Irwin raid. It's a little unclear which of these is actually accurate. In the end, though, the images seemed to be less of a lead than the officers may have been hoping for. They had released these images because they depicted multiple women, most of them who appeared to be unconscious, and the officers believe that these women may be connected to the West Mesa murders in some way. It was ultimately determined that one of the women was dead, but that she had passed from natural causes, and at least two of the women were positively ID'd as women who were still alive and well. Eventually, Irwin was cleared and removed from the suspect list. Now, Scott Lee Kimball, who is a convicted serial killer, was reportedly under investigation as another suspect back in 2010. Kimball had been convicted of the murders of 4 people between January of 2003 and August of 2004. He had pled guilty to these murders in 2009. Strangely enough, Kimball was actually functioning as an FBI informant at the time of the murders. Now, Kimball has denied that he had any involvement in the West Mesa murders. Yet another suspect was Robert Howard Bruce. Bruce had confessed to multiple sexual assaults that had happened between 1985 and 2007. In these attacks, he would break into a woman's home and then he would chloroform her. After this, he would handcuff her and sexually assault her. Now, these crimes reportedly occurred in Texas, Oklahoma, Colorado, and New Mexico. Now, Bruce was eventually sentenced to 200 years in prison. The MO for this particular suspect doesn't really seem to match up with what we know about the West Mesa murders, though. The last suspect known to be on the list is a man named Joseph Blia. Blia would join the same rank as Lorenzo Montoya when it comes to suspects in this case. Blia was termed the mid-school rapist or McKinley middle school rapist due to his crimes in the 1980s. Blia would break into the homes of 13 to 15 year old girls who lived near the McKinley middle school in Albuquerque while wearing a ski mask and carrying a knife. Once inside the home, he would rape the girl at gunpoint. A rape test kit had been tested in 2010, which definitively linked Blia to the rapes, and Blia would be sentenced to 90 years in prison. In addition to this, though, Joseph Blia had a number of other run-ins with the law, most of which involved violence, including domestic violence, and other sexual assaults and harassment. Now, one crime in particular that Blia is believed to have been involved in was the murder of a prostitute, which occurred in 1985. The murdered prostitute, Jennifer Lynn Sherm, was determined to have traces of Blia's DNA on the inside portion of her waistband and belt at the time of her death. Jennifer's body had been found on Central Avenue in Albuquerque. Now, when it comes to possible connections to the West Mesa murders, there were a number of things that led police to Blia. At the time of the victims' disappearances and murders, Blia had been operating a landscaping business. Now, this led him to make a lot of purchases at a particular plant nursery in Albuquerque. During the search of the remains in West Mesa, a tag was found buried deep in one of the graves. Now, this tag came from a plant that had been purchased at the nursery that Blia frequented. In addition to this, Blia was known by police to have frequented prostitutes and to have been violent with them. Even Blia's two former wives were aware that he would go out late at night to pick up prostitutes. One of these ex-wives is also quoted as telling the Albuquerque Journal that Blia often speaks about his hatred for prostitutes, calling them dirty whores and slaves. Joseph Blia was known to have an intense hatred of prostitutes. This is a common factor among killers of prostitutes. It also came out that in the years prior to these events, Blia's wife and daughter had come across multiple mementos that he had kept from various prostitutes. Some of these things actually involved clothing, which may be important to this investigation because none of the victims had been buried with their clothes. Perhaps Blia had murdered the women and kept their clothing as trophies. So what are the theories in this case? One of the early theories in particular was that the person who committed these crimes was regularly traveling to New Mexico for the state fair. Though we can't pinpoint the exact day that many of the victims disappeared, it doesn't seem likely that they all disappeared around the time of the state fair. Each year, the New Mexico State Fair is held in September, which seems to have been true even in the early to mid-2000s. Most of the victims had actually been last seen during the first half of the year in which they disappeared, so it does seem unlikely that the state fair has a connection to this case. It also seems that officers gave up on this theory fairly early as the victims were being identified and the timeline was beginning to be fleshed out. Another theory in this case is that a cop was involved. In 2014, it was announced by the Justice Department that the APD was under monitoring. There had been a civil investigation that revealed an issue of excessive force in the APD. In all, there were about 20 cases between 2009 and 2012 that were connected to this excessive force. Many of them were shootings of suspects by police officers. There was also a number of sex scandals in the department, and one claim in particular was that an officer had been sexually assaulting prostitutes. So could a cop be involved in the West Mesa murders? It's certainly possible. If there is one thing we know for certain today, it's that many officers in law enforcement view their role as a source of power and authority, which they can exploit for their own gain and desires. In addition to this, there had been rumors that a cop had been decapitating prostitutes and dumping them in West Mesa. Maybe there was a possible connection, and the rumors were more truth than speculation. As with a number of cases, there is always the question of whether or not a killing or series of killings was committed by one person or a team of persons. This is another theory that we will be revisiting soon in an upcoming video I'm doing about the Colonial Parkway murders. Now, it has been theorized that more than one person may have been involved in the West Mesa murders, but not as separate serial killers. Instead, they functioned as a team. Now, there have been team killers before. Some of the well-known ones are Paul Bernardo and Carla Homolka, Fred and Rosemary West, and Leonard Lake and Charles Ng. So it's not out of the question that team killers may have been responsible for the West Mesa murders. There are also expanded lines of thought on this theory that also include that the murders could have been connected to gang activity or a prostitution ring. When it comes to evidence of this theory, though, there is none. It's still possible, but as of yet, there isn't any evidence of multiple people being involved. A strange theory in this case is the idea that the West Mesa Bone Collector may also be the killer of an indigenous woman in Canada named Amber Takaro. Amber had been abducted while trying to get a ride into Edmonton from the hotel that she had checked into on August 17th of 2010. Amber's skull was discovered 2 years after her disappearance. It was eventually revealed that there was an audio recording of a phone call that Amber had made while in a man's car. People believe that Amber's killer may be connected to the West Mesa murders because of another recorded call. A private investigator named George Walker, who worked for Final Notice Investigation Services Group, he claimed to have been receiving emails and phone calls from a man who claimed to have committed the West Mesa murders, and to have more information about other missing women from Albuquerque. A video posted to YouTube in September of 2015 compared the two calls, and many believe that the callers do sound similar. Here is the audio from the Amber Takaro case.
Where are we by?
We're just heading south of Beaumont, or north of Beaumont.
We're heading north of Beaumont. Yo, where are we going? No, this is a... Are you f***ing kidding me? You better not take me anywhere I don't want to go. I want to go into the city. Jeez. Yo, we're not going into the city, are we? No, we're not. Then where the f*** are these roads going to?
50th Street.
50th Street, are you sure?
Absolutely.
Yo, where are we going?
50th Street.
East, right?
East.
Over down.
Problem.
And here is the audio submitted by George Walker in relation to the West Mesa murders.
You know who I am. I know who killed her, and I know who did it. And I know why. Okay, bye.
A lot of people have voiced opinions that the calls do sound like they could be the same person. While this is a theory in this case, there doesn't seem to be any evidence that would suggest that the man who called George Walker was actually involved in the crimes. In addition to this, it was reported by KOAT that George Walker had claimed to offer his services to the families of the victims of the West Mesa murders, but the families claimed that they had actually never been contacted by him. So I do find it difficult to take these claims from George Walker very seriously. The last theory that we will cover today is the Lisk connection. Some have theorized that the West Mesa Bone Collector and the Long Island Serial Killer are the same person. The Long Island Serial Killer is the name that has been given to the suspected murderer of multiple women who had drug problems or did sex work or both, who all went missing between 2007 and 2010. Now, these women would eventually be found and their bodies were dumped nearby each other. These women were also in a similar age range to the West Mesa victims. The timelines might work out and the situations may be somewhat similar, but there is still a lot of controversy over whether or not all of the victims in the Lisk case are actually connected to the same person, or if it was multiple people who happened to be using the same dumping site. Now, I don't know much more about this case other than the fact that it is widely disagreed whether or not all of the women's cases are connected. It is possible that the West Mesa Bone Collector could have moved away before the bodies were discovered and began killing in a different location, but for now, there also isn't any evidence to support this theory, and so it remains just that, a theory. According to some articles, police in Albuquerque have changed their outlook on prostitutes. One woman interviewed by the Albuquerque Journal told reporters that the police used to laugh in their faces when they reported a rape or other attack, but now these officers seem to actually take them more seriously, and they even actually investigate these reports. Following the discovery of the West Mesa murders, Christine Barber began the Safe Sex Work Organization in October of 2012. Her goal was to help women working on the streets and to hopefully prevent another West Mesa Bone Collector case from happening. Eventually, Safe Sex Works transformed formed into Street Safe New Mexico, which is now a statewide nonprofit organization. One of the very important aspects of the organization is the creation of their bad date list or bad guy list. This is a list of accounts of attacks that women have suffered from clients, and they are often included with a description of the person and their vehicle. Now, the mission of the nonprofit is to protect both the health and the safety of women who live or work on the streets. The work that Street Safe New Mexico is doing is truly important and has helped to connect many women together to help them be more vigilant and to keep them more safe while working as prostitutes. I've included a link to their website and the sources pinned to the top of the comment section if you would like to check out what the organization is all about, which I would definitely highly recommend doing. One of the leading causes of deaths for prostitutes is actually homicide. Sex work is considered to be one of the most dangerous work environments in the United States. Women in sex work are extremely likely to be targeted for violent crimes, including homicide. In a court statement from 2003, Gary Ridgway, the Green River Killer, stated, "They were easy to pick up without being noticed. I know they would not be reported missing right away and might never be reported missing. I picked prostitutes because I thought I could kill as many of them as I wanted without getting caught." The violence that prostitutes face often comes at the hands of their clients or their pimps, but a study from the Urban Justice Center that looked specifically at prostitution in New York City found that 30% of sex workers interviewed reported having experienced violence at the hands of police officers. This statistic is especially chilling when we think about the rumors that Cinnamon Elks had mentioned prior to her disappearance about a cop attacking prostitutes, decapitating them, and dumping them in the West Mesa. Now, to be fair, this was a tiny study in which only 30 women from 6 different areas of New York City had been interviewed, but of only 30 women, 10 of them had faced violence from police officers. When 0 woman in sex work should have to fear violence from police officers, that is already a lot. According to a document that was created and released by the FBI and the US Department of Justice, the West Mesa murders almost perfectly fit into the statistics of murders where prostitutes were the victims. It was actually a little disturbing reading through it because the case seemed to fit in essentially every regard they studied. In this same document, it was stated that the murder of a prostitute can be very challenging for law enforcement investigators to solve. The covert nature of sexual activities, coupled with the number of interactions with strangers, makes identification of any customers who may be critical witnesses extremely difficult. This same report from the FBI shows that about 29% of serial killers target prostitutes, which again just goes to show how important the work of organizations like Street Safe New Mexico are. Now, the Albuquerque Journal reported last year that investigators still receive about 1,000 tips each year about the West Mesa case, and Lieutenant Scott Norris is quoted as stating, "There's no tip that's insignificant. The littlest thing could lead to a break in the case." To this day, the case is still considered to be active. Though a number of family members of the West Mesa victims have passed away, many still visit the site where their loved ones' remains were found from time to time. Now, in June of this year, the West Mesa Memorial Park was officially dedicated to the victims of the West Mesa murders. Though it took a couple of years to fully realize the initial concept and there had been funding issues that had stalled the project for a while, the park is now complete and not only serves as a reminder of women who had lost their lives, but it's also a place for those women's families and for other people to come back and remember the lives that they had lived, to feel closer to them. There are still women who are missing from the Albuquerque area who were on Detective Ida Lopez's list of missing women. These women include Darlene Trujillo, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on July 4th, 2001, Martha Lucher, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on September 3rd, 2003, Anna Vigil, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on January 1st of 2005, Felipa Gonzalez, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on April 27th, 2005. Nina Heron, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on May 14th, 2005. Jillian Henderson Ortiz, who disappeared from Moriarty, New Mexico on January 16th, 2006. Chantel Waits, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on March 15th, 2006. Leah Peebles, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on May 22nd, 2006. Vanessa Reed, who disappeared from Albuquerque, New Mexico on June 13th, 2006. If you have any information related to the case of the West Mesa murders, I would highly urge you to contact the APD at 505-242-2677. If you are a sex worker or someone living on the streets in New Mexico and are in need of help or other resources, then I would highly suggest that you try to contact the Street Safe New Mexico organization. It is never too late to ask for help if you need it. So what are your thoughts on today's case? I have to say that if I had to pick a potential suspect, I would think that Montoya or Blia were the most likely, but that certainly doesn't mean that it couldn't be somebody else who may or may not have been on investigators' radar at some point during the investigation. I do think that the histories that both Montoya and Blia have, though, strongly correlate with things that are often seen in serial killers of prostitutes. At the same time, I'm also pretty curious about the bad cop angle. I think we all know that it's possible for a cop to do terrible things, and with the rumors that have been going around at the time, and the way that prostitutes have described their interactions with officers in Albuquerque during that time period, it wouldn't be a huge leap to think that it could be an officer that had been involved. But I would really like to hear what your thoughts and theories are on today's case down below, so be sure to leave a comment and let me know. Just remember to remain respectful. As I said at the top of this video, I will not tolerate comments that shame these women because they were sex workers or had struggled with drug addiction. Any comments like that will be deleted. As always, I do ask that you help to share these cases by sharing this video, someone else's video, or any of the sources provided to help keep them in the public eye and to hopefully inspire someone who may know something about the case to come forward. Thank you so much for watching today's video, and I will see you all again very soon for another case.